Lord God, you gave us Brantley, York, Braxton, Craven, and the gift of Trinity College. Give us the vision to start new things. You gave us John F. Crowell, Washington Duke, Julian S. Carr, and the gift of a setting in Durham. Make us a blessing to this city. You gave us James B. Duke, William Preston Few, Benjamin N. Duke, and the gift of wealth and ambition. Make us founders ourselves. You gave us Julian Abel, Mary Duke Biddle, Frederick Haynes and Ellen Shipman, and the gift of buildings and gardens. Make us agents of renewal in your world. You have given us the Duke family and a host of benefactors, trustees, presidents, and people of servant hearts and wise judgments. Inspire us to make this university a universe of praise to you. Amen. If you'd like to take the large blue hymn books in front of you, we shall sing the first and the final verse of hymn 117.
Be seated. I welcome you to the Founders Day Convocation, and in case you don't know it, I hasten to inform you that this is the 110th observance of Founders Day. Founders Day itself was founded in the year 1901, about 7 years after Trinity College had moved to Durham, as a holiday in gratitude to Washington Duke, and when it was called Benefactors Day. A century later, we continue to gather to pay tribute to those who founded this university and to everyone, faculty, staff, and student whose labors continue to establish and realize the dream of the university every day. I'm going to begin by introducing our speaker for today, Karl von der Heyden. Throughout his distinguished business career, Karl von der Heyden, a 1962 graduate of Duke, has led some of the most recognized and respected corporations in the world. In many ways, that career journey began with his journey to Duke. As a child born in Germany, Karl lived through the privations of World War II and then of the communist occupation during which his father was imprisoned. In the depths of the Cold War, this young man who had already seen so much followed an uncle's advice to seek his educational fortunes in the United States. Coming by ship from Germany to New York, he then rode a bus to Durham, a dry town in the segregated South, where he enrolled as one of the absolutely minuscule numbers of international undergraduates at that time. This was globalization before globalization. Despite that culture shock, Karl experienced a series of intellectual encounters and friendship encounters here that helped to shape his future. He left Duke first for Wharton, then for a business career that included top leadership roles at H.J. Heinz, RJR Nabisco, and PepsiCo. His business brilliance led his wisdom to be sought by everybody putting a board together. And if I mention two, it will only be two of the many boards he has served on, the New York Stock Exchange and DreamWorks. He also has shared that business acuity with Dueck. After service on the Fuqua Board of Visitors, Karl von der Heyden was elected to the Board of Trustees of Dueck in 1995 and was quickly, shall I say, honored with the ability to serve on the Business and Finance Committee, the Audit Committee, every other committee, and finally the Executive Committee, and finally as Vice Chair of the Board, in addition to doing a second duty as a board member of the Dueck University Health System Board of Directors. In all of these roles, he struck a careful balance between encouraging adherence to the strictest financial discipline, but somehow making that seem compatible with the wildest and boldest ambitions. Away from Dueck, Karl and his wife Mary Ellen have been supporters of the American Academy of Berlin, of which Karl chairs the board, and the Cullman Center at the New York Public Library. Here at home, he has and Mary Ellen have funded an international speaker series, scholarship aid for international students, and most recently, a building that bears their name. You thought von der Heyden was a building, but it is in fact a person, or people, Karl and Mary Ellen. That soaring, inviting space, you know that when Perkins Library was redone with the addition of Bostock and von der Heyden, library use increased 40% in 1 year. We should have done that a long time ago. But in any case, it seems to me that was itself an example of the continuing founding acts that friends of this university can perform. Dueck has few alums who have taken their education so far or who have brought so much back to this place. Please join me in welcoming this year's Founders Day speaker, Dueck alumnus and leader, Karl von der Heyden.
President Broadhead, Provost Lang, members of the Board of Trustees, distinguished honorees, faculty, students, staff, and friends of Dueck University. I'm honored to stand here before you today. Thank you, President Broadhead, for the kind introduction, and thank you all for your recognition. The Founders Day speech is a long-standing tradition at Dueck. Please forgive me if you will hear it delivered today with a different accent. The founder of Dueck University as a university was James Buchanan Dueck, who lived from 1856 to 1925. You all know about his distinguished family. His father, Washington Dueck, and his brother, Ben, were also major benefactors of our predecessor institution, Trinity College. James B. Dueck's major gift in 1924 made a university out of Trinity College. When I attended Dueck in the late 50s and early 60s, the school was just over 30 years old. That tells you something about how young this university really is. It's twice as old as it was when I attended here. And it also tells you something about how old I really am. And look at the fact that one of the granddaughters of Benjamin Newton Dueck, Mary Dueck Biddle Trent Siemens, is alive and well in the midst of our Dueck community. In a photograph of J.B. Dueck, you see him attired in a dark three-piece suit with a cigar in his mouth. He is surrounded by a coterie of similarly dressed other men. You see a capitalist in the true sense, intensely interested in business since his teenage years. He didn't think much of education in his young years. He dropped out of New Garden, which is now Guilford College, after less than one term. He could not, quote, see the use of it. Instead, he and his father started peddling leaf tobacco from the family farm. They called the tobacco pro bono publico, for the public good. Later, he formed the American Tobacco Company, a cartel that controlled about 95% of cigarette sales in the United States. The American Tobacco Company was organized in 1890. That's the same year in which the Sherman Antitrust Act was passed. But it took the regulators 18 years to catch up with J.B. Dueck and break up his monopoly. The Duecks were definitely not anti-black, but there's no indication that they had misgivings about racial segregation. Dueck University began as an all-white school and didn't begin to integrate for more than 3 decades. So looking at J.B. Dueck from today's perspective, there seems to be quite a bit wrong with this man. We are honoring whom? Smoking isn't even allowed anymore at the school that was founded mostly on tobacco money. We're striving today for as much ethnic, gender, and racial diversity as we can possibly get. Our law school teaches us all about antitrust legislation and the evils of monopoly. But before we become dismissive about our founder, let's appreciate what every student of history knows. We can look at the past with the eyes of today, but we shouldn't judge the past with those same eyes. James B. Dueck, as the people of his time saw him, was a deeply moral, religious, and law-abiding man who lived in a society that shared his values. Tobacco was a reputable business. Its devastating health hazards had yet to be discovered. Antitrust regulation was in its early stages, and J.B. eventually had to accept the breakup of the American Tobacco Company. Racial segregation was a deplorable but accepted way of life in the South, and not just in the South. So he lived comfortably with his core beliefs. But J.B. Dueck was not just a comfortable citizen living the average life. His success in business and in life was not an accident. The man had the drive to succeed, and he had vision. Let me give you a few examples. First, early on in his career, he committed his company to the first machines that mechanized the rolling of cigarettes. The machines were fabricated by the Bonsack Company. That was at a time when the competition stuck to hand-rolled cigarettes, which were long considered superior in quality. And they were, until the Dueck Tobacco and the Bonsack people perfected this machine. From then on, Dueck had the big competitive advantage that propelled him to the forefront of his industry and to his huge fortune. Second, as a 28-year-old, he left Durham to go to New York to run a satellite cigarette-producing plant. He never lived in Durham again, and soon the entire business was run out of 45 Broadway. But he never forgot his roots. He once said, quote, "The country boy can come to town and soon learn all the town boy knows, but the town boy can never get all the country boy has had." Third, he had the vision to go global with his business at a very early stage. "Bring me the atlas," he said. One of his associates went abroad for 19 months, setting up operations in England, Scotland, and Ireland. Then the continent, Belgium, Holland, France, Germany, Scandinavia, St. Petersburg. After Europe, Bombay, Delhi, China, Singapore, Java, Australia, New Zealand. Then Cape Town and Durban. For today's entrepreneurs, that's a fairly common way to go. But in those days, it was really, really unusual. Fourth, he had the vision and drive to enter the hydroelectric power business after his tobacco monopoly was broken up. He was highly successful in this business as well. Companies today rarely diversify into entirely new businesses that are outside their comfort zone and core competencies. But he did, and he made it a success. And fifth, he modified his views on education in later life. And a good thing it is, because if he hadn't, there wouldn't be a Dueck University. But meaningful charity work came late to J.B. Dueck, because for him, business was his life. When it did come, however, it came with a vengeance. The indenture and deed of trust establishing the Dueck Endowment came with the same vision and meticulousness that had characterized his business life all along. So here's a man we can admire and are justified to honor in spite of the fact that he was far from perfect. But while we should be careful about judging J.B. Dueck with the eyes of our time, what would he say if he were plunked down among us today, almost 80 years after his death? I believe he would be pleased. His university is thriving and has grown considerably in size and stature. He would welcome the diversity on today's campus because he was always a globalist. He would particularly welcome that women are equally represented among the students. He would understand that the school is integrated because the Jim Crow laws then prevailing in the South must have struck him as odd. He and his family had accepted segregation, but had staunchly supported black schools and churches all along. He would even understand the non-smoking laws on campus once he familiarized himself with the medical risks of smoking. He would be very proud of the medical school and the Dueck-run hospitals because healthcare was such a big issue in the then largely rural Carolinas. And he would applaud Dueck University for going global, not just with its student body, but also by planting the Dueck flag in faraway lands. The words outrageous ambition are often used about Dueck University, and mostly by us Duckies ourselves. Boldness and restlessness have indeed been in the DNA of our university ever since JB founded it with his large gift. It is not every day that a new university is created from scratch, as this one was, not far from the old Trinity College. Now plans are underway to create yet a third campus to close the gap between East and West and to accommodate new ambitions. We value traditions like this Founders Day, but our minds are far more occupied with our future than with our past. When I arrived on the Dueck campus in 1957, literally off the boat from Germany, West Campus hadn't changed much since it was built in the late 20s. And East Campus had changed even less. There had been a depression followed by World War II. The South had fallen behind with its segregation. Because of it, Southern universities were not in compliance with and did not benefit from many federal programs. But things have changed rapidly in the South and even more rapidly at Dueck. It's been fun to watch that change. On my first day on campus, a freshman counselor showed me to my room and watched me unpack my suitcase. My mother had packed for me a special bottle of German white wine to give to Dr. Hans Lohenbach. Dr. Lohenbach, who had left Germany because of the Nazis, was a highly respected and prominent psychiatrist at the Dueck Medical Center. He had helped me to get into Dueck. When I produced the wine, the freshman counselor almost had a heart attack. If he reported me, I might possibly be expelled. I would have had the shortest tenure of any student at Dueck. If he didn't report me, he would violate the student honor code. I had trouble understanding his dilemma, partially because of my poor English, and partially because of the concept itself. Wine is illegal? Verboten? To a European, that takes a while to sink in. Fortunately, my fellow student didn't report me, and I'm still grateful to him. Another tidbit, when you entered the cafeteria in those days, attractive cigarette girls would sometimes distribute free sample packs of cigarettes. Smoking was fine, drinking was not, even for 21-year-olds. I had several part-time jobs at the Dueck Hospital in order to make ends meet. One job was in the dietetics department in the basement, where I had to take orders for food that was then distributed back to the wards on hot trucks. Down in the basement, I became friends with a black man who worked in the boiler room. This friendship was remarkable in that for quite a while, we didn't understand each other. His accent was even more difficult for me to understand than that of the white Southern professors I encountered in the classroom. And he didn't know what to do with my German accent. But we soon understood each other. He was a World War II veteran who had fought in the Pacific. His son was a professional baseball player with, I believe it was, the Cincinnati Reds. I foolishly asked him if his son had gone to Duke and immediately realized that he couldn't have. Here was the American-born son of a World War II veteran who couldn't attend Duke. And here was I, a white man from the defeated Germany, who could. The injustice of this discrimination was striking and blatant. It took Duke almost four more years before integration started. If 1961 seems like the distant past to some, it isn't to me. But Duke did change. Now you can drink alcohol, but are no longer allowed to smoke on campus. You have to be 21 in North Carolina to drink because that is a state law that Duke has to enforce for better or for worse. As with the drinking laws, Duke has to exist in the world as it is. But it can be and is a force for change. We have an admirable level of diversity at Duke, but not yet an admirable standard of intermingling. Self-segregation continues to exist. It still needs work, but will get better. I'm confident of that. Change is endemic at Duke. Our founder was a capitalist of the old school. The word capitalist is not generally viewed as a positive attribute in polite academic circles. Capitalists are not usually nice people, and there's no indication that James B. Duke was a particularly nice capitalist. But it's interesting to note how many of these 19th and early 20th century robber barons have left behind lasting legacies. Think of the Rockefellers, Andrew Mellon, J.P. Morgan, Andrew Carnegie, Cornelius Vanderbilt, Leland Stanford, and yes, the Dukes. Their fortunes were accumulated in different ways, not always commendable ones. But don't their names sound to your ears like a roster of prominent private universities? Today, there's once again a big gap between the ultra-rich and the rest of us. All the laws and regulations of the last century have done nothing to prevent this. There are indications, however, that at least some of the ultra-rich of the present have a conscience similar to the robber barons of the 19th century. Education, healthcare, and other endeavors of major importance depend on it. Our institution has benefited and is continuing to benefit from the generosity of thousands of individuals and foundations, and yes, from some very rich capitalists as well. This will get us to the next level. The Duke Endowment also continues to use its leverage in key areas affecting Duke's future. On this Founders Day, we can celebrate the success of Duke University. We are young, a restless school, and our best days are still ahead. James B. Duke would be proud to know that the guidance expressed in his beneficial trust has not just survived, but has thrived in all these years. Thank you.
Thank you. As Dean and Vice Provost for Undergraduate here at Duke, I have the enormous privilege of meeting and working with amazing students, all with different backgrounds and talents. And that makes my role in this service of introducing our undergraduate scholarship recipients all the more special for me. In the indenture that created Duke, Mr. Duke requested that the university take great care in admitting students whose previous records show character, determination, and a real ambition for life. Now, those characteristics could describe just about any student here at Duke, but some of the students we admit have special achievements that have earned them scholarships, and we recognize those scholarship winners here today. Now, as I call out the name of each scholarship, I'd ask the recipients of that scholarship who are here to please stand and remain standing until all of the undergraduate scholars are recognized. A full list of scholars' names and the scholarships they've received are listed in your program. I would ask that everybody please hold your applause until we reach the end, and then we will celebrate them all collectively. Two of the scholarships mentioned today are named for members of the founding family of this university, about which we just heard so much in a remarkable speech. The Andrew B. Duke Memorial Scholarships, the oldest of our merit scholarship programs, are awarded to exceptionally talented students from across the United States and from around the world. Please stand. The Benjamin N. Duke Scholarships recognize the achievement and potential in leadership and community service by students who are specifically from North and South Carolina, again recognizing the Duke family's commitment to this part of the world. Please stand. Two more of our scholarships are linked to the early roots of Duke and are awarded to outstanding students from our home state. The Braxton Craven Scholarships, established in honor of Trinity College's first president, recognize the accomplishments of students from Davidson County, North Carolina. The Trinity Scholarships are awarded to North Carolinians in honor of Trinity, North Carolina, where our school was first founded. Now from North Carolina to the world. This is the first year for the Karsh International Scholarship, which was established by Duke trustee Bruce Karsh and his wife Martha to bring talented students from around the world to Duke. And they are a remarkable group of students we have in this first class. Please stand. The Reginaldo Howard Memorial Scholarship was created in memory of Duke's first black student body president to provide scholarships to students of African descent with outstanding leadership ability, scholastic achievement, community involvement, and evidence of serious commitment to a life in service to others. The students from the Robertson Scholars Program get a college experience like no other, especially here in Tobacco Road. Robertson Scholars, who have distinguished themselves as future leaders, are selected to attend Duke or the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, and they're given the opportunity to attend classes at both universities. The scholarship is named for Duke benefactors Julian and Josie Robertson. The Duke Alumni Association Scholarship was created in 1979, the Alumni Endowed Scholarship, I should say. It's awarded to children or grandchildren of Duke alumni based on their academic achievement, leadership performance, and extracurricular accomplishments. The Baldwin Scholar Program bears the name of Alice Mary Baldwin, who was the first woman to have full faculty status here at Duke and was Dean of Women from 1923 until her retirement in 1947. This program was established in the fall of 2004 to support a community of undergraduate women in campus leadership roles. I'd like to now have us applaud and offer our congratulations to all of our recipients. We thank you. We thank you for the contributions you're making at Duke, which are very important to us, both in and out of the classroom, and you may now be seated. Now, before moving on to the rest of the program, I know that the university scholars at this point often are saying, hey, what about me, the undergraduates at least, but actually we save the university scholars program for the end because it's a unique program in recognizing both undergraduate and graduate and professional students to participate in interdisciplinary study. And in fact, the graduate and professional school fellows play a special role in this program by serving as intellectual leaders and mentors for the undergraduates in the program. So would the university scholars please stand? Thank you and all of our undergraduate scholars for all you do for Duke.
As the university's chief academic officer, it is my pleasure to acknowledge the achievements of our graduate and professional school students. From the early days of the university, graduate and professional school students have not only pushed the boundaries of scholarship as well as their mentors, the boundaries of their mentors, but have also important roles in teaching and mentoring undergraduates. This tradition of scholarship and teaching continues today and is exemplified in our next set of awardees. I would ask the student recipients to stand as I call the name of your fellowship and remain standing. A full list of the students' names and fellowships are listed in the printed program. Please hold your applause until all are standing. The James B. Duke Graduate Fellowship and the Dean's Graduate Fellowship provide funding to identify, attract, and develop outstanding scholars who wish to pursue a program leading to the PhD in the graduate school. Since many graduate students are actively engaged in teaching, the university recognizes those students who have excelled at the front of the classroom. The BAS undergraduate instructorship is awarded to graduate students who have demonstrated outstanding qualities as teachers. The International Research Travel Fellowships, supported by the James B. Duke Endowment, were created to allow students to conduct their research abroad in the dissertation phase of earning their PhDs. And they are, in fact, abroad. The Pratt-Gardner Fellowship is an engineering student graduate scholarship program established by the Gardner family in honor of Duke Civil Engineering alumnus William H. Gardner, Jr. This fellowship program supports all active graduate students who are helping to develop a scholarly community that promotes interdisciplinary exchange. Congratulations to all of our fellowship recipients. You may now be seated. Thank you. I would like now to acknowledge and commend some of my faculty colleagues for their outstanding contributions to teaching and service to Duke. The university's first obligation has always been to attract, nurture, and retain faculty of the highest excellence, where excellence is understood to include both powerful intellectual creativity and an eagerness to stimulate and support the creativity of others. While we pride ourselves on the quality of all our faculty and the impact they have on students, whether undergraduate or graduate, there are some who have excelled at teaching and deserve special acknowledgement. I would like to ask all of this year's faculty award recipients in attendance to please stand and be recognized. A full list of their names and awards are located in the printed program. Congratulations to you.
There are 33,000 employees who work in support of the university's mission of teaching, research, and medical care. To celebrate the work that our employees do to shape and sustain this community, each year we recognize 5 men and women who have exceeded expectations to deliver service of the highest rank. These individuals are the 2010 recipients of the Presidential Award, the university's highest employee award. The awards were presented earlier this year, and we would like to recognize the winners today. I would ask if they are present today for the following to stand: Chris Adamczyk, Wes Phillips, Tammy Tuck, and Gerald Wilson. I would also draw attention to the regrettable absence today of Tamara Overreach, who won the 2010 Presidential Award and who passed away last month. Our congratulations and gratitude to the winners. I'd now like to acknowledge other members of our staff who have been honored for their performance this year and would ask that they stand when their award is called. First, the 18 winners of the Meritorious Service Award, singled out by their peers for their exceptional contributions to the university in their many areas of responsibility. Second, winners of the Dueck Diversity Award, awarded to staff and faculty members who've shown leadership in promoting the values of inclusiveness and respect for differing backgrounds and points of view within the university community. And third, the Dueck Teamwork Award, recognizing groups or teams of staff and faculty who have fostered cooperation, collaboration, and open communication throughout the university. Congratulations to you all. Congratulations. We next honor individuals who deserve special recognition for their outstanding contributions to Dueck and to society. We've invited them to sit on the platform, and I will invite them to stand while I recognize them. First, I'm pleased to announce that Anthony Kelley, here he is, an associate professor of the practice in the music department, is this year's recipient of the Alumni Distinguished Undergraduate Teaching Award. Did I hear someone whistle? The award is administered by a panel of undergraduate students who select the recipient based on letters of nomination submitted by members of the student body. This award includes a $5,000 stipend and $1,000 for Dueck Library to purchase books recommended by the recipient. Fittingly for an award presented by the Dueck Alumni Association, Anthony Kelley happens to be a double Dueck alumnus himself, having earned an undergraduate degree in 1987 and a master's in 1990. He's written award-winning compositions and is well known for finding inspiration in lots of different forms of music, from classical, ragtime, and blues to jazz and pop. Through his courses on theory and composition, he introduces new generations to the complexities and pleasures of music. Explaining the musical, literary, and legal theories of borrowing in his compositions, as he did at a recent conference at the Dueck Law School, he leads us so effortlessly through the complexities of his argument that it becomes as clear as a familiar melody. But Anthony Kelley's care for students goes far beyond the class. Since 2001, he has been a faculty member in residence on the East Campus, first in Southgate, and more recently in Brown. His apartment, equipped with a baby grand Steinway, draws in students seeking planned or impromptu jazz sessions, and as teacher and mentor, he has supported students' passions for music and helped them find ways to integrate music into their studies and then their future careers. In recognition of all you have given to the students of this university, it is our pleasure to bestow on Anthony Kelley the Alumni Distinguished Undergraduate Teaching Award. At Founders Day, we usually present the University Scholar Teacher of the Year Award. This year's recipient had a reason he could not possibly be with us, but it seems wrong not to draw attention to his achievement. The winner this year is William Chafe, the Alice Mary Baldwin Professor of History. William Chafe will be known to everyone in this room as one of the leading historians of the American Civil Rights Movement, someone who took his study and especially the opening up of fields of oral history and communal history to study the somewhat comparable history of apartheid and the struggle to end apartheid in South Africa. Most recently, he has taken groups of Dueck students to South Africa in Dueck Engage programs that build on the study of history. For these and his many other accomplishments known around the country, he was given the Roy Rosenzweig Distinguished Service Award given annually by the Organization of American Historians to that historian in the entire United States who has done most to promote the love and sense of the value of history. We will present Bill Chafe with the University Scholar Teacher of the Year Award at the next meeting of the Academic Council, but maybe we could have a little applause for him in absentia. The Distinguished Alumni Award was established in 1983. It's the highest honor given by the Duke Alumni Association. It's presented to alumni who have made significant contribution to their fields, in service to the university, and to the betterment of humanity. From nominations made by alumni faculty members, trustees, administrators, and students, the Duke Alumni Association has this year selected Wilhelmina Reuben-Cooke of the Class of 1967 as the recipient of the 2011 Distinguished Alumni Award.
Oh, stand there. Stand there, and I'll see if I can make this look. Yes, sir. Don't move.
Wilhelmina Reuben-Cooke, in the days when I believe she was known as Mimi Reuben, was among the first five African-American undergraduates to come to Duke, arriving at a campus that was a very different place from the Duke we know today. Her leadership and engagement helped teach this university that an environment that was welcoming to all students would allow everyone to flourish. She was an influential leader as an undergraduate and also an outstanding student, graduating with Phi Beta Kappa honors. As an alumna, she has brought exemplary volunteer service to her alma mater, notably as a two-term trustee and chair of the Academic Affairs Committee. Though her term as trustee ended before I came here as president, I can testify from abundant experience that she continues to be there for Duke in circumstances both challenging and festive, and on all known occasions brings her trademark combination of warmth and eloquence and wisdom to the occasion. She has said, one of the things that always struck me about Duke was how Duke was constantly working through its emerging identity while making sure that it articulated and stayed true to its core values. Wilhelmina has a long record of academic accomplishment, including her service at the University of the District of Columbia, where she has served as provost and vice president for academic affairs, and where she is now professor of law. Today, we are pleased to present Wilhelmina Reuben-Cooke, who has managed to be a pioneer, and I think we dare say a founder of this university in her term, with the 2011 Distinguished Alumni Award. Almost 20 years ago, the idea was born to create a special award to recognize extraordinary service to the university. It was agreed that the award would be reserved for those who have close ties to Duke and whose contributions have had unquestionable and long-lasting impact on the life of the institution. The award medal is symbolic both of the university and its mission, bearing the seal of the university and its motto, Eruditio et Religio. It honors selfless devotion to education, public service, and the values of this university. The award is called the University Medal for Distinguished Meritorious Service, and Duke is pleased to award it to two recipients today. First, I will call up Professor James Bonk. It is apparently totally unnecessary for me to explain who James Bonk is. Jim Bonk is a certified Duke legend. Not long ago, the introductory chemistry course at Duke was affectionately and universally, though not quite officially, renamed Bonkistry after the man who had taught it for 40 years. When this beloved professor stepped down from teaching Chem 11 and Chem 12, he was presented with two custom-made blue and white tennis jerseys marked in honor of his official course numbers, Bonk 11 and Bonk 12. Bonkistry was the primary point of entry into the world of chemistry for more than 30,000 Duke undergraduates spread over four decades. Committed to undergraduate education and brilliant at communicating his excitement for chemistry, Jim Bonk has had an enormous impact on students and served as a model of good teaching for many who are now themselves teaching in universities and medical schools. His influence, even beyond the course sequence that made him famous, has been transformative, perhaps alchemical. Largely as a result of his relentless efforts, independent research in chemistry and the undergraduate chemistry curriculum in general are now far more robust and more intellectually challenging and far more student-focused. Jim Bonk has had a long association with the men's tennis program at Duke. A one-time tennis player described a frustrating afternoon when every ball he hit fell just short of, about an inch short of clearing the net. He recalls, "Dr. Bonk took me aside and said, 'Son, I have looked at your racket, I have checked your grip, I have watched your serve, and I think I figured out what you need to do. Hit the damn ball 2 inches higher.'" With appreciation for your legendary and enduring contributions as a teacher in many spheres, Duke is proud to recognize James Bonk with the University Medal. The second university medal goes to someone I have already introduced once. This is Karl von der Heyden. I will only say this as you step up, Karl. When you were first a trustee, when you were a trustee and I was newly the president, you met with me in New York City and you looked at me with your stern eye. You have other expressions, but you do have a stern one. And you said to me, "Remember, Dick, no surprises." What good advice. So what an unfortunate surprise for you that we are revoking your university medal now that we have detected their verboten white wine incident. Student this university is proud of, leader, a person who took success in life and used it as the means to build support for learning in other countries, in your native city, and at this university, Duke is pleased to confer on Karl von der Heyden the university medal. And now, will you please stand and join in the singing of the alma mater?